A very good afternoon to one and all present in this webinar. I, Pranjali from fourth year, cordially welcome Mr. Nelson Macquar today at this virtual platform. I also extend a heartiest welcome to all the fellow attendees. Our college has come up with various webinar series during this COVID-19 crisis, like landscape architecture, conservation architecture, products and furniture design, and many more. Now we are here with a practical dimension of architectural practice, that is insights of real estate valuation. And today we have Mr. Nelson Macquar, who will be sharing insights on land economics, town planning, and valuation. I request Professor Taha Padrawala to give us a glimpse of our college. Thank you, Taha sir. Now I would like to take this opportunity to introduce Mr. Nelson Macquar. Sir is a civil engineer and practicing valuer for real estate and plant and machinery as well as law graduate. He was a faculty at Masters of Valuation course ISTAR Sardar Patel University Vallabh Vidyanagar before he started his practice of valuation. He is a secretary of CVSRTA, an association of qualified valuers. He has authored study material in valuation for Shivaji University, Annamalai University, as well as for examination conducted by IBBI. He also imparts training in valuation at mandatory or continuous education programs for registered valuers under Companies Act 2013. It is our privilege to have you, sir. The platform is yours.
Thank you, Pranjali. So I hope, am I audible completely? Is
yes,
it fine?
Sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So it is not required out loud, louder than this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Sir, it's clear. It's perfect.
Okay. Thank you. So at the outset, I thanks SVIT and the College of Architecture for giving me this opportunity to dwell into the three varied disciplines of land economics, town planning, and valuation, and to the Faculty of Architecture. And I really appreciate and acknowledge Pragnesh Shah, who was one of my colleagues, and we had a same institute, studied in the same institute in valuation and for having this insight of blending architecture with valuation. I really appreciate that, Pragna, is your effort and bringing three of us over here. One, two from the faculty and one from the leading practitioners in the field of valuation. And Rajiv is also coming on day after tomorrow, he'll be there. So he's also an international practitioner in the field of valuation. Right, so really it's a unique feature Pragna you have brought about, and your institute is really leading in that. And I'm sure, I assure you that during whatever the time, I have not seen the time allocation, what time it will take for my this session, but hope it has been less than one hour. And I'll definitely make it this session interesting for you. And at the end, we must have a fun out of it, right? So that is what my intention is. So before starting, I will like to let you know that after this end of the session, where you will be left, right? So normally we have in our life, there are the three domains in our life. One domain is that I know that I know. So for example, I know the civil engineering and planning, I know valuation, I know speaking in English, I know speaking in Gujarati, like that. I know that this skill I know, or this concepts I know, right? So with that knowledge, I use it or I don't use it. And there is some little bigger domain in our life is, I know that I don't know. Right now I know that I don't know architecture. Right now, I don't know that how to speak in a Spanish language. So what is opportunity in this domain is with me is, I can go to the architect college or get hold of the architect faculty and learn the architecture and start doing that, using that. Or I may not use that. I study the architecture for sake of knowledge, right? I may not be practicing the architecture. So for example, I have a degree in a law. I do not practice in a law. I use that knowledge of law in my valuation. Right. So if this is the second domain, that is that domain I call it, I know that I don't know. I know that I don't know something. Right. And the third and the biggest domain, that is the domain occupy about 99.99% of our life, is I don't know that I don't know. Is there any example for this? That is my example for this, right? So at the end of this session, my intention is to leave you in the second domain. That domain is, I call, I know that you don't, I don't know. So in this session, I will make you, take you through the various things, that is land economics, particularly with urban land economics, town planning and valuation, and how they are interconnected with each other. What is the role of architecture? What is the role of valuer? And as an architecture, how you can practice as a valuer, or how you can make use of creating a value for your asset, creating a value of your client's asset, client's property. How you can contribute to them. If you contribute to them, to our clients, and definitely they will pay you more. If you are putting your client in advantageous position by creating an asset in such a way that they make profit out of it, they make gain out of it, right? And definitely, they definitely share their gain with you, right? So with this background also, I'll deal with that. So before going, let me share the presentation with you. Now, hope it is visible now.
Yes, sir. Perfect. Perfect.
Okay. Thank you for your support. So, the today's topic, that is, as I said, it is a land economics into bracket urban land economics, town planning and valuation. Right. So, when this world of economics and all that comes up, people will think of, oh, what is to be studied in that economics, right? And basically that economics is, it is a very simple, in day-to-day life, we use the economics, right? So it is, economics is basically the discipline which deals with the distribution of scarce resources, allocation of the scarce resources, so that we can derive the maximum efficiency out of use of those resources, right? And when economics comes in, that markets invariably comes in, right? And then when market comes in, it's always related with the behavior of the human beings. So how human being behaves within the market. So this economics brings in study of human behavior, basically. Human behavior in relation to distribution and allocation of scarce resources, so that they can derive the maximum benefit out of it. And secondly, that second discipline, that is, today we are incorporating is the town planning, or so you can say the planning, right? So since that, as I said, the land is one of the scarce resource, right, which is limited in our supply. We cannot increase the supply of land on this planet. At least we can reclaim a sea or other water bodies, and we can reclaim the land, and we can use that if it is an economic. So land being a scarce resource, and particularly the urban land is a scarce resource, we need to have a planning for utilizing those scarce resources. We need a planning to allocate those scarce resources. And the third discipline is valuation, right? So valuation is a discipline. It is, why I say it's a discipline, it is the Rupesh must have dealt with yesterday, that the valuation is a discipline, or it is an exercise that is primarily deal with the economics and law, right? So how your land has been, how economically land has been used, how it has been planned, and by doing so, this your land, which is a subject matter of valuation, that commands certain value. Where it commands the value? In market. So the valuation is basically it's a discipline which uses the knowledge of various disciplines, say economics, law, say your town planning, that insurance, then architecture, environmental issues, even building technology, building construction, so many things. Valuer required to have a knowledge of various disciplines, not all the knowledge of various disciplines, but the relevant knowledge of other disciplines, so that he can practice as a valuer and is provide his professional services. Right. So here I'm trying to make a blending of the economics and planning and valuation. Right. And ultimately, we at the end of the day, we want to have this value creation. Right. So how that understanding of land economics, particularly urban land economics, and how the understanding or the provisioning of various planning proposals or the planning will contribute to augmenting or increasing or creating a value. So you all must have traveled through a train, all right? And if you look at outside the window, you must have seen the ample of land, right? And I said land is a scarce resource. It's a scare, but if you see outside the window of your train, you can see the ample of land lying barren as it is, or you will find some agricultural use, right? So how that land is scarce, but urban land is scarce. If you go to the Mumbai or go to the Hyderabad, go to the Baroda, right, you will find that the same land becomes a scarce. Scarce means it is not easily available. Right. So it is very difficult to have, or rather to put in another way, it is very essential for a person to practice the discipline of valuation. All right. because it is not only the land economics and town planning, it requires a lot of knowledge of law also, right? But as architect, how you can deal with this subject of valuation, and how you as an architect, not as a valuer, as an architect, to contribute in creating a value of our properties, right? So we can in another way we can say that, so if you see that any society, what is the aim of the society or human beings, what is the aim of the human society? It is ultimately to maximize its welfare. कैसे भी करके सब वेलफेयर करना, सबका भला होना चाहिए, मैक्सिमाइज इट्स वेलफेयर, राइट? एंड सो हाउ दैट मैक्सिमाइजेशन ऑफ वेलफेयर ऑफ द सोसाइटी टेक्स प्लेस, सो देयर आर बेसिकली टू फैक्टर्स दैट इन्फ्लुएंसिंग द वेलफेयर ऑफ द सोसाइटी, एनी सोसाइटी, इट इज मीन इफ यू बी लिमिटेड बाय द ज्योग्राफी और इट इज लिमिटेड बाय द प्लैनेट, राइट? एंड सो हाउ दैट टू फैक्टर्स आर the way the society uses its limited resources, including land, and how the distribution of income between the members of societies takes place. So how that gap between rich and poor has been minimized. How the income generated has been equally distributed among all, those who are living on this planet. Right? So this is what the, if you see at the macro level or broadest level, say society's aim is to maximize its welfare. And in doing so, they will have to allocate. Their the best allocation they have to do of their scarce resources or limited resources. It is either a land or it is a crude oil, either it is the environment, right? So they have to allocate, best allocation they have to make, so that economic efficiency has been achieved and it brings in the welfare of the society, right? And ultimately that whatever income is generated out of this, it is to be distributed equally amongst the members. So let us now go into what is the role of architect versus valuer, or the role of architect and valuer, right? So first and foremost is the subject matter. So with what valuers and architects deals with? If we look at the cursor, if you look at it in a very simple way, both are dealing with the land. Valuer looks at the land in some different way. Architect looks to the land in a different way. So valuer sees the land. Lucas must have yesterday discussed with you that land valuer see the what are the rights and interests arising out of the land, and what are the rights and interests that lands or the building thereon gives you, what rent it commands, what utility it gives, and that is required to be valued, right? And if you look at from the architect point of view, so he sees as a land how best he can make use of this land, how best he can plan out this land, how best he can put up a building for a small building for his client, or put up a entire township type building with all the amenities and facilities and all landscaping and all that thing. Or if at the town level, how he make a such an infrastructure development and the planning of the various competitive use, and so that it can make a best town out of it, right? So this is with what architect and valuer both are dealing with the same thing, that is the land, right? And but both are having a different point of view, both are having a different, they are wearing a different goggles, and they look at the land in a different way. So when that role of architecture comes in, when the role of valuers comes in, so if you see, architect roles comes in creating a property. So land, developing a land, putting up the buildings or factories or residential house or multi-story buildings or office complex or townships or developing entire town. But valuers comes in after all this been set out. Then valuers role comes in and they come to value that, what is that value of that particular asset, a particular house, a particular industry, particular industrial building, or particular shopping complex, or a shop in a shopping complex. Right. So valuer comes after that asset has already been created. But whereas the architects create the assets, create the utilities out of the land. Say if you put a land as it is, as you've seen out of your window of train, outside the window of train, the land by itself is unproductive unless and until it has been improved upon. So that is, architects plays the role in causing or creating an improvement on or over the land. And valuers come in when it, pardon? Yes?
No, sir, continue. It's a glitch when they join, their mic is open.
Yeah. So, anything is there, just let me know.
Yes.
Right. Otherwise, I will continue because I cannot see the.
Please continue. Sorry for this.
Right. So that role. So in creating a value, what valuer put a value to a house, or say industry, or a shops or a shopping mall, that depends upon how the architect has provided, how architect has developed that in terms of creating the maximum use of those land, right? Providing the different features to it. How that space has been architect. Right? So this is the, so that architect can contribute in creating a value of an asset of a client. All right. So what they do? What architect do and what valuer do? Say if a client comes to an architect and he says, I want to have a two luxurious villa, one in the city and one 5 kilometers away in a rural settlement where there is no any other development. Then architect very well plan out and design and execute this construction of luxurious villa. Right. Both the places in a city as well as 5 or 10 kilometers away from the city. Land area is maybe the same, villa design planning may be the same, right? And in away from the city, there must be some extra cost of labor. So the cost may be the same, cost incurred in the both creating a both luxurious villa and in city and outside city will be maybe the same, nearly the same. Right, but if you then valuer comes in to value both the property, and if that your client wants to have a same loan on mortgaging those two villas, right, valuer will put a different value to both of the things. Whereas architect can advise his client that yeah, you can construct a villa at both the place with the same facilities. All right, but if when that person wants to sell and it goes to the valuer and appointing a valuer and asking him to value this two villa because he wants to purchase. So the valuer will put definitely a two different value to both the villa, though they are identical, they are the same. Right. So this is the how the architect and valuers, having a different point of view, different context, they look at the land and they advise their clients. Right. So before going into the details of our subject, let me clear out two concepts. One is a value in use and another is a value in exchange. Right. When market comes in, then the action must take place. Right. When exchange takes place, then and then that particular things may command a value. See, world value is a very subjective term. What is value? right? It's a, if you ask me what is the value of my this shirt, right? I can say X amount, right? But if I ask Mahatma Gandhi, what is the value of the shirt? He must say zero, right? So value is very highly subjective. But so not going into the definition of the value and cost and price, Rupesh must have dealt with yesterday. But here two concept I want to like to deal with is the value use and value exchange. So for example, if I ask you a question, what is the value of your home? Anyone of you unmute and say, what is the value of your home? Anyone? Taha? Unmute and ask someone and ask him to.
Pranjali? What can you answer?
Yeah. What is the value of your home?
Sir, but it might have changed from the time I bought it. Like it's been around 5 years that we bought a home.
Manjali, don't go into that domain. What is today? What is the value of your home today?
I don't know, sir.
Say any X amount. Huh? Any X amount?
Yes.
So you said you don't know. Okay. Why you don't know? You are staying in that home and you don't know value of your home. Very strange. Anybody else?
Bhavini. Bhavini.
Okay, so the Pranjali, right? So Pranjali did not give the answer. What is the value of his home, her home, right?
Yes. Sir.
Why? Because she was not answering this question. Why she had said no? She do not know the value of his home because she is answering this question. How much value it has? He could have said, value of my home is enormous. At the end of my class, I go home and enjoy like anything. Right? But she was trying to answer how much value it has. That's why he could not put a figure amount on that value of her home. Right? So this is the, because one is value, what is the value of your home? The answer lies in value in use. How that home is useful to me. But if the second question is we try to answer that how much value it has, then we look into what it will command in exchange. Right? So that value may be divided into two broad categories. One is value in use and another is a value in exchange. The value in use refers to the value of an item or an object to a particular user. Right? So Pranjali was trying to answer the value in action. So what value that home is giving to her, she was not able to quantify because she wanted to find the value in action. So that what item or object, what value it gives to the particular user. If a commodity is capable of being used and providing satisfaction, then it has a value to use. So I give you another example. So what is the value of an oxygen? The oxygen you are having, right, which is abundantly available. We do not put any value to that. Right? It is amply available. But if environmental pollution is increasing, then that the oxygen, which is abundantly available, becoming more and more valuable, right? And the same oxygen, if you're going on the Mount Everest, you require the oxygen more. Then you take along with you the oxygen cylinder, right? So you pack the oxygen into the cylinder and take, right? So that oxygen which was abundantly available, it is having a value in use, but on Mount Everest, that will command value in exchange, and you pay for the cylinder of oxygen. Right. On other hand, value in exchange is a describe the value of a thing to a people in general. Value in exchange can be estimated only for item or the properties that are commonly bought and sold in the market. That is exchange for money or its equivalent. Right. Say, for example, the mother or wife cooks at home. It commands value in use. But if when that mother and wife has been replaced with that cook, that same service will command value in exchange. So I use extreme example of. So for example, a mother carry a child in a womb for 9 months. It's a value in use. It doesn't, that carrying of a child doesn't command any action value. But as soon as that mother is replaced with a surrogate mother, that same carrying of a baby in a womb, it will command value in exchange. Right? So when the thing is abundantly available as a free gift of nature, or it is abundantly available, service available out of love and affinity, that commands value in exchange. As soon as the thing which is abundantly available, that abundant love, it becomes scarce, then that will command, that same goods or services will command value in exchange. Father teaches to son, that is value in use. As soon as the father replaces himself with the tutor or in the tuition class, then it will become value in exchange. Right. So anything that, and basically we as a valuer, we are concerned with the estimating of value of what things or the commodity or the property in what it commands in exchange, not in use. Right. And anything or any services will command value in exchange when it becomes scarce and it becomes capable of transferring from one end to another hand. Then it will command a value in exchange. Right? So keep this concept of value in use and value in exchange in the background. Right? So that exchange takes place, that it will bring in the market of that property, market of the real property. Real property, what is real property? I just dealt in a couple of slides. What is real property? So, but you can say that real estate or real property or land and building, right? So what is, where exchange takes place? An exchange takes place in the market. And if you go into the market, what you will find? You will find in the market a price of a commodity or the services or the things or the real property. You will find the price, and that price has been set out by interaction of demand and supply. It has been set out by demand has been created by the buyer and supply has been created by the seller. So if you put it, the market in a sense, that market is a group of buyer and group of seller, and both group are brought into the communication with each other at given price, they will exchange goods and services. So that is the market. So exchange takes place in the market at price. And what determines the price? That demand and supply, buyers and sellers of that particular real estate or particular goods and services. They create. Right, and people, buyers want at the as minimum as possible, at as minimum possible price, and the seller want to supply at as highest price he wants to supply, right? And unless and until both motives meet, then some price agreed between buyer and seller, and at that point action takes. So invariably, in order to command anything of value, it must be capable of exchange, and that exchange must express into the market. Right. So I'm not going to detail of this economics or types of market and all that thing, but for time being, have this understanding of the market. Right. So as I said, what is real property? So as I said, real property is a land. Right, that is a crust of the earth. Right. So is it only the land? It is only the real property. It is only land. Is only the land has been exchanged? No, land is remain as it is. There it is, wherever it is. It is just like a ball pen. One, it is not going from one hand to another hand, or from shopkeeper to the buyer. Land remains there. That land plus improvements. Improvement means anything that has been embedded to the land, or anything attached to the land. Embedded to the land means that building is embedded to the land, the rest of the through the foundation, and then the superstructure is standing. And improvements also includes that anything which is embedded, anything which is attached to the things which is attached to the embedded to the earth. What does it mean? Say for example, a window. Window is attached to the wall, and that wall is embedded into the earth. So that wall along with the window, it's improvement. Improvements maybe to the land in terms of earth filling or clearing and making a fencing or creating a compound wall. These are the some improvement you will take on, and you constructing the building on their own. Right? So there is some tangible improvements you take there takes place. And you architect are expert in doing that, creating an improvement over the land. So what you create, that has been included into the real property or real estate, which is the subject matter of valuation. Right? And one more thing which is intangible that includes in a real estate or real property is interest therein. Rupesh must have dealt with yesterday, right? So what is the interest? Right to derive the benefit out of land and improvements putting to the legal use. What are the rights you are having to derive benefits by putting this land and improvements to the legal use? Say for example, I am owner of a house, right? So owner of house means that I am piece of land, there is a building standing there on, and I am the owner. So I can use that house for anything. I can occupy myself, I can give it to my friend for occupation, or I can give it on rent to another person, or I can mortgage to the bank and obtain the finance on it, and I can lease out to the somebody else, or I can leave it as it is. Right? So as an owner of a house, I can do anything with that. If I want to sell it, I can sell it out. If I want to give it to my friend on after my death, it goes to my friend. I can write a will and dispose of to my friend. Or if I don't dispose it through will, the law will take it goes and it land, my property will go to my heirs. Right. So this is the real property. Right. So it is a blending of a physical things, tangible things in terms of land and improvements, and intangible things, that is in terms of interest. Right. And valuer task is to value all things, this tangible and intangible. So valuer's task is to put a value to the interest which is arising out of ownership of the land and improvements. Right. And whereas architects plays a role in developing this improvement. Right. So now, let us see the nature of the real property and the real estate. Right? Because see, I'm creating the background for the economics and planning. Right. So, Taha, as you said, there will not be any time constraint. So, I'm going little.
Yes, sir. No problem.
So what is the nature of real estate or real property? That is the physical characteristic. So as I said, it is the land and improvement. It is not merely merely the land and improvement. It is so many things goes into. What is, you can see that is the shape, that is the size, extent, or you can say the, if you don't, you cannot see that is the, what is the load bearing capacity of that particular soil, right? And improvement, how, what improvement you can put, right? And what improvement you can put, it has been restricted by the planning proposals, right? So many things are there having impact on these physical characteristics, physical use of the physical characteristics of land, right? And another characteristic is the legal characteristics, right? That is, a transaction in the land is not so much as a dealing in the physical thing, but more so in the legal rights which runs everything, right? As I explained earlier, and Lucas has yesterday dealt with in the detail of this, what are the legal characteristics which is required to be taken into consideration. And another thing is the economic characteristics, right? So this is the one of the important aspect that we have to look into. One is economic characteristics. It is, the land is immobile. It cannot move from one place to another place, right? And it is a large economic unit. In the sense, if you want to buy a shirt, or if you want to buy a refrigerator, or if you want to buy a TV, you can go and buy that, right? But economic unit, large economic unit, means you require a huge amount of money to purchase or acquire those land, right? And it may also require some financial arrangements to have this, to own this land, piece of land, right? And it has been durable. Durability in the sense, land is indestructible. It is lying, going to lie there as it is. And whatever the improvements will take place in terms of the buildings or the structures, right? They are being constructed with the intention to last for a longer period, not less than 50 years, more than 50 years, right? And at the same time, the land is a scarce. Which land is scarce? Which is the particularly the urban land is a scarce, right? And land by itself is unproductive. What does that mean? If you don't put a professional, say you don't hire an architect, right? You cannot improve upon your land, right? You cannot put a labor in that, constructing a building or make out of use of that land. You cannot get the use utility from that land. And at the same time, there must be some entrepreneur or some person must be there who can develop that, right? So then, so in economics, there is a four factor of production. That is the land, labor, capital, and entrepreneur or management, right? So land by itself is a, one of the factor of production, in which if you don't apply a labor, capital, and the management to it, it is not capable of producing anything for you, right? Except the, even if you want to have that agricultural pursuit out of your land, it requires putting up labors and as well as the capital, and as well as you need to manage it, right? Unless and until you blend the land with the other factor of production, it remains unproductive, right? So as you've seen, that chunk of land lying barren outside the window of the train. Right. So these are the immobility, large economic unit, durability, scarcity, and the land by itself is unproductive. These are the various economic characteristics. So immobility creates a lot many things, another economic complications, right? So being immobile, right, the person needs to go to the land and see it, how it is, and then he can purchase. It doesn't come to your home, right? So many things will take place. So and legal characteristics is also important, because it is basically a government, when government exercises his three powers, police power, taxing power, and power of eminent domain. So how in exercise of those power, government makes various laws, which has impact on utility of your land. Say, for example, in exercise of the police power, governments can say that you cannot use your land for X purpose. Say you cannot use your land for, say, hazardous industry at this particular location, right? So that is an exercise of police power, right? And if you want to sell, you will have to pay the capital gain tax. That is a taxing power. And power of eminent domain means when if your land is required by the government for the public purpose, they can acquire land. Say, for example, widening of the road or establishment of, say, public hospital or, say, this bullet train project. So they can acquire the land under exercise of the power of eminent domain. Right? Say, rivers and mountains and roads, all these are belong to whom? It belongs to the government. And in that is in exercise of the power of eminent domain. Right? So, and this, when government exercise these various powers, they will restrict the use of land. They frame a planning law, they have town planning acts. They restrict commercial in a residential, or they restrict a residential use in an industrial zone, or they restrict the use of industrial zone in the residence. So these are the exercises of the police power, or three powers of the power of government. And that will restrict the utility of your land. The lesser the utility, lesser is the value. Higher the utility, higher is the value. Right. So there are the two pieces of land. One land is here on my right hand side, another is on the left hand side. So in right hand side, the FSI is 2, and on left hand side, there's a FSI is, say, 4. Both are side by side, two plots of land, but they will command a different value. Because here in FSI 2, I can have a less utility than this plot having a more FSI. Right? So both will command a different value. So all these physical characteristics, legal characteristics and economic characteristics will blend it in a such a way that it will create a value. Or you can have a highest value, and how much depress the value, and whatever the remaining is, that is the value of your property. Right? So this is what the nature of the real estate. It is having the three characteristics: physical, legal, and economic. And another factor that also influence the value that I'm not dealing with right now, because I'm limiting myself to economics and planning. Right. So now let us see what is the function of property market. Right. So I will go into the briefly, not in the detail of this function of the property market, that is, it allocates existing real property resources and interest. Right. So to which these particular property is being put to use, residential or commercial or institutional or industrial or some other purpose, right? That depends upon that how it has been demanded into the market. It indicates change in a demand for the land resources and interest. In particular, say, you say that in particular road, there is a lot of demand for the commercial shops, or in particular area, there's a lot of demand for the residential house. Right, so that market, because there the people create a demand, where the buyer goes and they want to have asset there, property there, right? So that indicate the change in the demand for the land resources and interest. To induce supply to adjust to the change in the demand. The market says, oh yes, in this particular location there is a demand for the residential, or in this particular location there is a demand for the office premises, right? And this will induce the supply in that particular area, right? Or some new road has been taken place, so they will induce the demand along the road for the commercial, right? And supply will adjust to that demand. It also indicates a change in the condition upon which the land resources can be supplied. Say, various condition it generates, and to respond to the change in the condition of supply, whether I should supply that particular land into the market or not. And it rewards the owner of the land resources, right? So ultimately we get gain in terms of price you get for your asset or the land or the property in the market. So this is what this function of the real property market, right? So now this is a very important thing. So who are the market participants, right? So particularly the real estate market participants. Right, so these are the three groups. One is the space consumer groups, space producer group, and the public infrastructure group. Right, So now let us see who are the space consumer group. So space consumer group, you can see at the top. This is a space consumer group, right? It has been subdivided into the two, the space users, collective user, and the future user. And another group is a space producer group. It has been divided into three, skills, capital, material. And another group is a public infrastructure group. It has been divided into three, that is a utility, services, and a security system. And all are, these three groups are dealing into the sites and improvements, right? So it's dealing with the land and building, right? Sites and improvements. So who is this space consumer group? This is a space user group. So they will, if they see the benefit in this site improvement, right, and then they either take a decision.
3 plus GST data.
If the space user group, they are ultimately using the property, so either for the residential or for the commercial or office as establishment or industries or like anything. But it's a different use, they will definitely put that particular property to use, right? And they take a decision either to hire or take in the property on rent, or either to purchase. Producer group who supplies this improvement to the space users, right? And space user pay rent and price to the space producer group, right? And this is the collective users. So collective user, basically you are the political pressure group, right? Say in a planning process, you know, you might not have experience like that, but those who are already in a planning, involved in the planning process, they have experience, numerous pressure from the politicians, right? So these are the, they will try to define the particular planning, particular area under the planning to be used, to be utilized for the particular use. So they are called the user. So future user means that is for what the land is being required for the, say, future expansion of the city or construction of the bridges or the flyovers or the roads or some other purposes, or establishment of the schools and hospitals. So this on expansion of the city. So they will use this future user group, right? And then what is the space producer groups is comprising of three things. One is the skill, capital, and material. That is in like architects and valuers and lawyers and broker and insurance agent, and all this will provide the various things into the in the various skills they provide, right? And at the same time, there is another is a trade group. Trade people like, say, the mason or carpenter and all that thing. This they will provide this skill to what? To sites and wonder to develop the sites. Right? They provide their skill to this site. And that's capital, that is mean either maybe capital will come from the investors, either maybe person maybe investing that is their own institutions and the equity capital from investors, individual investors and the developers, right? They provide the capital to these sites, right? And the materials, so various materials is required to create these improvements, create the property, right? So there is a material supplier group is there. Right. So ultimately, all this group, what they provide, provide capital and capital gains to this to this sites and improvements. They provide various trade group provides the various services to this, and they will create the sites and improvement. And if that sites and improvement is creating a benefit to the space, go for the either purchasing or renting that what has been created here, right? So here the architect will play a enormous role in development of a site or creating an improvement, right? Which will be beneficial to this user group, space user or space consumer group, right? And if that has been useful to them, it is having a beneficial utility to this group, and they will provide either they for go for the rent and purchase, right? So if at all if the site has been developed, but that site has not been connected with the telephone line, not connected with the internet connection, not connected with the gas pipeline. So many things, electricity, gas, right? And if this site has been developed and people who are utilizing this site, they may be required the services of the schools and hospitals and so many things. And they want to use these sites and improvement peacefully. There must be a law and order, there must be protection to them. Right, and that requirement has been fulfilled by the public infrastructure group. It is basically this public infrastructure group may or may not be the public owned. It may or may not be provided by the government. It may be the private players may be there. They may be providing the water supply. They may be providing the gas supply. Right, they may be providing the schools and hospitals. Yes, and when and this site is connected with the road, connected with the electricity, connected with the drainage line, connected with the water supply, it will enhance the value, right? So this is, and the locality will be providing the protection of the law that has been by security system, that government provides the security into this area, right? So that it will create the value to this sites and improvement. So these are the basically three players in this entire real estate market. These are the three participants. And these three, if anyone is not winning, then this real estate market collapses. Everybody needs to win. So that means this entire system is required to be solvent. If anyone player is not playing well in this market, then it will collapse. So the relationship between that space consumer group and the space producer group, it is our social system. And the relationship between this improvement space user group and the public infrastructure group, it is our political system. And the relationship between the space producer and the infrastructure, there has been enterprise system, right? So I think is it clear for everyone? So these are the three space production group. They provide their skill. So now let us go to the why development takes place. Over the period of time, that demand for the land resources changes, brought about by changes in the size of the population, income and taste of the population, then rate of growth of economic activity, the method of transportation, techniques of production and distribution. All this will brought about the demand for the land resources. And when there is a demand for the land resources, development takes place. Right? So there's an increase in the population, you need to develop, right? And if that income level increases, then demand for certain things, more housing will be increased, more industry maybe increases. If taste of the population changes, it will create demand. Say for example, now the taste of the population is to stay in a holiday home life away from the city, then there will be a development takes place outside the city. That development takes place outside. There is a new development takes place outside the city, right? And method of transportation. Now, easy connectivity is available. New, say, metro train has started and the connectivity is available. So the new area comes up, right? And on supply side, if you see that the existing building wear out, it then slowly and gradually deteriorates, right? And become less suitable for the present user. And then cost of construction, new building or adopting old changes. So cost of construction, there's a change in the cost of construction, reduction in the cost of construction, and more utility being developed, right? So then supply of that particular housing increases. So development is a response to the changes on either supply side, on the demand side. If both side, it has been certain change happens, the development takes place, right? So indeed, the development process may have to be dynamic. The one development generate development elsewhere, right? So the provision of say road or provision of say for example that is a development of a say special community, right? So it has started generating development nearby. Say hotel development, other development started developing nearby, right? So one development generates development elsewhere, right? So development takes place in a three ways. One is the modification of existing building. Right. So if existing building is been now it has been earlier it was even used as a residential house, and now that locality is developed in such a way that there is a demand for the office space, not the residential, and people are paying more for the office space, right? Then existing building is required to be modified to suit the requirement of the office space. Right. So that modification takes place, the development takes place in that way. So sometimes the redevelopment takes place. So when redevelopment takes place, when the whatever the future income it has been capable of, you can derive from the existing use of that land, which is less than the whatever the barren site or the barren midland is there. So for example, there is a say one plot of land is there, right? But if you put up their multi-story building, if you explore the third dimension of land in terms of a multi-story building, which will give you the more value than if you have this small plot of land. Say, for example, in Vallabhidyanagar, the town, in now lot of it is having a 500 square yard. Now the lot of bungalows has been sold out and where multi-stories have come up, right? So whatever you derive the income from the bungalow, as I say, for example, a rental income, which is much less than if you demolish the bungalow and sell the land itself, because that land can be put more lucrative use. Like say multi-story building, say hostel building, or say commercial complex, right? So then redevelopment starts, and the new development takes place. The new city expands, urban growth, or it expands, and new development start taking place, right? And where this government also play a role by through the various planning proposal in developing a in creating a new development. Right. So now let us see, when development is not been planned, then it becomes a growth, and growth is normally undesirable. Right. So as an architect, you must have studied in your planning that distinction between the development and the growth. Right. Cities grows like as it is without planning. It will create a chaos in a long run. Right. So. There is a need to plan out the scarce resource, which is the resource right now is for us is the land, right? So that resource allocation, that is how you consume that particular resource, that is been required to be planned out, right? And at the same time, say why you require to plan? Because you plan that in a such a way that whatever the cost you put in, it gives a more benefit than the cost, right? So then that's why it planning is required. So if you put up a industry in a say remote area, what will happen? It will generate an employment opportunity in a remote area, right? And where the land cost is less, it will attract another development. Nearby the township development comes up. And but if you look at that same industry nearby the city or the within the city, you require to incur a lot of cost in our purchasing the land and put up the industry if it is permissible. Right? So that's why the planning is looked into from the economic point of view, how it generates. So let us see what is the rationale of planning controls. So here that planning, it has been always been done with the controls, all right? So here I just want to put forward the incomplete arguments for planning control, right? So planning control is to secure the better environment in which to live. Another is they ensure the most appropriate use of society's stock of land resources, having regard to the both the present and the future use, and reconciling the competing claim of the land use, competing claims for the use of land, right? But without further qualification, each of these arguments appears somewhat superficial when subject to economic analysis. So, for example, so let us see for the better environment. It is always we are always, and everybody likes to live in a live in a better environment, right? Everybody likes that. But liking the better environment and achieving that better environment is totally two different things, right? So putting up, say, green belt, providing a green belt within the city, right? It is for the better environment. But at the same time, if you put it, it has a lot of cost. But if you want to put a green belt zone, say between southern Mumbai and the suburban Mumbai, what will happen? It requires enormous cost, and it won't become a provision of that green belt for the economic betterment, better environment will become economic, right? So that takes place, right? And to ensure the most appropriate use, right, for the present and the future. So if our forefather might have put this all this our landed property to the most appropriate use, we might not have faced the traffic congestion and other environmental pollution and other things within our cities. All right, and at the same time, that their land is always having a competing claims to be put. Right, say for example, government wants to develop a town. Or say government wants to develop a certain area within the town, and there are certain parcel of land in which that certain people will putting hurdles in development, right? So in that, government can exercise its power of eminent domain and acquire and then remove those elements, and it requires enormous economic cost, right? So that it is very easy to say that is for the planning is essential for the better environment, have to make appropriate use for the future and providing for the competing claims on the land use. It is very easy, but it is very difficult to achieve. Right? So and this discussion must not to interpret when whatever I say there till now, that is not to interpret that it suggests the planning is unnecessary. Planning is necessary. Right. And to emphasize that a major schemes, as I said before this beginning of this session, I was discussing with the Pragna and the Taha. That is what it is here. To emphasize that for major schemes, economists must be the part of the entire planning process, rather than, as frequently happens, being called upon to analyze and appraise when the basic decision has already been taken for the planning. Right. And if the planner himself is understanding the economic principle, then it is going to be very useful for the making various planning proposals. Right. So that's why the land economics, and particularly land economics, is very vital for the planner. So what a planning control can achieve? So if you look from the point of view of the developers of a land, right? So for they view the planning control as a being negative, right? So you put, say, zoning restrictions, or you put certain other restrictions, and the developer will definitely look into the negatively. So I have to take so many approvals and sanctions and so many things, so many formalities to be done before the development, all that thing happens, right? See, but from the point of view of the community, if you see as a whole, that planning control can be obtain positive benefits, like improve knowledge. You can improve knowledge means in the sense you have a, if you have a beforehand, you plan out, so you can have adequate provision for open space, for the parks and playgrounds. You can allow for the sufficient allowance for the future need of the government. You can provide for the wider road. You can provide for the green belt control. You can provide for the density control, right? You can provide with the zoning controls. Say, and even you can have the complementary uses. So for example, there is some industrial use, right? So when industrial comes in, the industrial zoning comes up, and if you don't allow the residents nearby, then that industry, we won't get the labor at the cheaper at the lower wages, right? So you need to provide certain complementary uses along with the main uses, right? So zoning control is to be done in a such a way that it also make an arrangement for the complementary uses of the land to which it can be put, right? So dealing with the perfect competition in the market, the exercise of the power of eminent domain, when, as I said, when the owner of a particular site standing in the way of the comprehensive development, then the government can acquire that land and develop. Then you can, with the planning, you can have a provision for the public use, for infrastructural aspect and land use. As I said earlier, that is the concept of the value use and value action. Say the construction of the roads and construction of the bridge, construction of the flyovers, construction of the dams, all these are commanding the value use, right? But it is ultimately a beneficial to the community as a whole, as a society as a whole, right? So these such type of provisions for the public use can be made beforehand through the planning controls, right? And improving the mobility of resources. As I said earlier, that if you have planned an industrial zone, then you can have a complementary use, provide for the complementary use of, say, residential townships, right? So that can be achieved, right? So you can, mobility of resources means that land, that is a entrepreneurs, then laborers and capital, that you can easily move. And then redistribution of income, right? So redistribution of income means you can have a plan out within the city, say nowadays it is a affordable housing schemes are going on, right? So it is an attempt to redistribute the income. Say the people who are having a lesser income, maybe they are provided with the dwelling units, right? So that is a affordable housing schemes that they comes up, and it is an attempt to redistribution of income. So you can plan for, you can achieve the redistribution of income through providing affordable housing within your planning proposals. So that is what you can achieve. So ultimately, all this planning proposal will have an impact on the value of land, right? So how the value of land, so the planning proposal of, say, density control, say FSI, you can increase the FSI, you can decrease the FSI, and thereby you can control the density of population within the locality, right? And higher the FSI, higher is the value. So normally the land we can view as a two-dimensional entity, length and breadth. But nowadays, land is, we have technology and demand has created an impact, so that we can explore, provided as a facility that we can explore the third dimension of land in terms of high-rise buildings, multi-story buildings. Right? Normally, if you see in earlier days, we have a horizontal sprawl. Horizontally, development takes place. Now it has become a third dimension we are exploring in terms of multi-story building, and whereby we can provide for the vertical control also in terms of FSI, and we can control the density of population as well as the dwelling units. So which higher the density, higher the value of the in particular locality, it will create. So in your area, say now right now there is one locality, now the FSI has been, say, from 1 to, it has been going 1 to 1, 2. So definitely in that particular locality, because the, now the infrastructure is such that it will sustain, it will cater to the long double population. Then you can go for the double FSI. Then it will increase the value of the market. Right? You can also have in a zoning, you can have restrict the various use of land. Right? Say for example, now the particular locality, now it has been declared as now no residential development takes place in this locality. Whatever existing are there, it is there, otherwise no development takes place because nearby that one industrial unit is coming up, industrial complex is coming up. Whatever the existing residential housing are there, it will enhance into the value. It will command more value because the industrial complex is coming up. Right? And then it will create a synergy of complementary uses, right? And ultimately that if you plan out the area, it will ultimately increase the overall land value. If there is one barren land is there, but if the government comes up with a town planning scheme, they plan out the town planning scheme in that particular area, and they lay down the roads and drainage and all that thing, right? So in that it will increase all of us after the TP scheme proposal, automatically that land value goes up into this. Right? So this having this planning, it will person is having say planning consent or planning proposal, which is in getting the planning proposal, then he is permitted to use this land. That land will command more value than the adjoining land. Right? So it is also planning, various planning proposal has been made, which will bring in economic value of the property. It will command more value in exchange. It will command more value in the price. So whereby that demand and supply of a land and the various planning proposal come together, they will create a value. They will augment or increase the value of the property. So here I like to have one example, right? You can see that red line, right? It is earlier. This is from Anandtown, right? So this is a red line. It was earlier 4 years back. It was a canal. It is a barren, unused canal. It was lying as it is, right? So it has blocked so many areas. Right, this is the rail line, no? This was the canal, right? And now it has been developed as a double track road, two lane road, right? And this is the yellow line, no? It is one of the prominent road of Anand, which is joining Vidyanagar. Anand Vidyanagar road, or say AV road it is being called. It is one of the prominent road, and it is the highest commercial shops are there. Highest prices available, higher prices very high on this road. And this way, and it's going to the Tarap, right? This is another another road. And here this is the Elecon Engineering, where my cursor is. But this road, this canal was passing through the one industrial complex. And this area is the GIDC, that is the Vitthal Udyoga. This is an entire area. It is an industrial establishment, right? So now this road has been created. It has opened up. So this is the Mogri village, connectivity to entire GIDC, because this and GIDC is having the road rectangle to this, right? So it has opened up the connectivity to the city easily. Otherwise, earlier people has to, from the Anand, if you want to want to go, it has to follow this path, right? And then you can go to the GIDC. Now it is directly connected to GIDC throughout this plan, up to this development. This is the new world of Vidyanagar. This is the ADIT Engineering College and all that thing here. This is the entire new Vidyanagar campus. So it is joining, connecting to the new Vidyanagar with the city. Otherwise, people have to come through GIDC, moving zigzag, and they can reach to the college. Now it has opened up direct connectivity with the road. And what happened in this, there are 8 to 9 commercial complex have come up. Started coming up. It has not been, right now it has not been completed, but coming up. So there are the one commercial complex coming up over here, having a 9-screen multiplex and the mall, with the mall. And here that already one mall has been electronic stores and consumer durable store has came up over here at this point, at the end. And here also one Infinity cinema is coming with the mall, having a 4-screen, right? So by simply having this road, earlier it was a canal, say about 15-screen cinema and malls are coming up in this road, all right? And what has happened? This road has already been developed right now, right? Fully functional. But what has happened due to this COVID, all these projects are now held up. So now development is not taking place. These are incomplete buildings, right? So this one planning proposal, that is convert this canal into the road, it has created an enormous economic impact in the surrounding land, in the surrounding area. This connectivity with the GIDC, industrial establishment, this is a huge GIDC, known as the Vitthal Udyog Nagar, right? So this is how the planning proposals will augment or increase or decrease the demand, and it will induce the supply. That's on this road now, because that is price, right? Reasonable price. So now having this road, which is also passing through the city, and it has opened up to so many areas, and it has provided the connectivity with this Vallabh Vidyanagar road and this Sujitra road, right? And this road ultimately connects to this blue line, which is the road going to the Nadia. This is the one of the main road of the Anand. It is the Dandipath, right? So it is, and then it is from this, it is going to the Baroda, right? So it is connecting to this, right? This at this junction, right? So that this is what the, how the planning proposal comes up and create a value, and which will open up a supply, induce the supply, and it will augment the value. And at the same time, due to this pandemic, what has happened? Now all this project have been standstill. Now no development is taking place. Now last couple of months, the people have started developing, but it is a very slow pace. When the road was established, it has worked very fast. All the 7-story, 8-story buildings have come up fast. But now the finishing is very slow, because now that because of the pandemic, it has demand has contracted. Right? So with this, I would like to end my this session. If you have any question on this, we can definitely have those questions.
We open this webinar for a round of question and answers. You can put up your questions in chat box or unmute yourself.
Sanjay, there is a question in the chat box from Pallana.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. So one of our faculties, Pallavi Mandle, is asking, I would like to know the allocation of land use in developing town planning scheme with supply side and demand side of market of property.
Say allocation of town planning, allocation of land at in which proportion?
I would like to know the allocation of land use in developing TP scheme with supply side and demand side of market of property.
Okay. See, whenever you are proposing any town planning scheme, right? So it is required to be balanced one, which provide for the present use as well as the future use. Right? So where the town planning scheme is coming up, whether within the city or outside the city, it depends. So if within the city and already some existing development has already been taken place, right? So you will have to provide the scheme in a such a way that, so for example, if I put it up, that if I can share the Google, then I can show you. Is it visible? Google Earth is visible to you?
No, sir.
It will take time, sir. It will come.
Yes.
Okay, anyways, leave it that. So, okay, it's fine. See, when you are making any town planning scheme, so you will have to allocate that land to the different uses. So residential, commercial, if industry is coming in, already been planned that, then it's some industry, or you will have to look into what is the existing use. So for example, in this nearby Anand town, there is a one town planning scheme, which has been now, it is just like a barren land, which is being blocked up between this railway track and the main city of the Anand. Right, so in that some scattered residential development has taken place. So in that entire land, there is no any commercial potential. So in that you will have to allocate the land for the residential only, and with a few some commercial pockets, and some institutional development and parks and playgrounds. But if it is within the say very near to the city or within the city, and now we are. Some growth has taken place, and in that you are wanting to have a town planning scheme. Then you will have to provide the land use which is in complementary with the existing use, not restricting the existing use, but it must be complementary to the existing use. Right? And if you do that, then and only then it will enhance into the value. So that demand and supply, see, demand and supply, if you want to have to look at the demand and supply and to utilize those demand and supply sense into the planning proposal, it is you will have to look into where you are planning a town planning scheme. If the town planning scheme is nearby the industry or nearby place of employment, or whether it is a purely having a residential use only, there's nothing. Right, so where you are planning that scheme, depending upon that, how your planning proposal will complement the existing use. Right, and since many times the town maybe have saturated, now development has already been taken, so there is no another space available for the development. So people and the population is growing. Right, so new area you would like to open up, then in that, if you are planning a town planning scheme. So you will have to look, there is a demand for the residential houses or the residential development, so you provide for the residential development. Or say some institutional development, so you can provide for an institution. Say for example, the town planning scheme designed near the Gift City and that is a law university and PDPU, right? So in that location, which is nearby the river, in that location, now the scheme 46 town planning scheme, something has come up right now. In that, majority of land is allocated to the institutional use, right? Rather than the providing for the commercial or industrial or say residential. The majority of town planning scheme, it has been used for the institutional. And in the fringe of the town planning scheme, they have provided for some residential development. Right? So that planning scheme has been designed to have a complementary effect on the already developed things, Gift City, Law University, PDP. Right. So I think that has addressed your question.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Pallavi. Any question?
I think there are no more questions. So I would request our Professor Pragnesh Shah to deliver the formal vote of thanks.
Yeah, it's my pleasure, sir, to give a vote of thanks to the today's expert, Mr. Nelson McQuan, sir, for sharing his knowledge very creatively to all of us. Mr. Nelson McQuan, sir, has also taught to me and explained the importance of the subject with discipline and very different manner. I would like to thanks to our principal, Professor Shailesh Nair, sir, for the support and encouragement to all of us. Today's webinar is 29th in number and series number 12. It is part 2 of real estate valuations, insights of real estate valuations for the requirement. Now, I would like to thanks to our NEST Trust and the chairman, sir, Sri Bhaskar Bhai Patel, for the motivation to all of us. I would like to thanks to all my colleagues, faculties and non-teaching staff for their constant support. Thanks to our younger faculty team for the technical supports and hard work for all of us. They are Mr. Professor Taha Padrawala, Professor Garbit Nayak, Professor Rutu Raj and the student committee. Lastly, I would like to thanks to Pranjali, always ready to give the MOC for the college. And I am very happy to have such team for the betterment for the SVIT. Thank you.
So I take this opportunity to acknowledge that College of Architecture of SVIT. And I also acknowledge the Pragnes for being taking on this effort for to motivate this young generation. And really, it is a commendable effort. It takes a lot, I know, because I'll be also organizing various webinars for our association. Yeah. So I know what it takes.
Yeah.
And thank you for being who you are for this faculty of your architect. Yeah. And definitely with all the participants, I acknowledge all of you for giving me this patient listening. Right. And hope you will be now dwelling into what I know that I don't know. I know that I don't know something.
Yeah.
In the planning and architect as well as in creation.
I must
have left you in that domain. Thank you everyone.
Thank you.
Have a nice day,
sir.
Take care.
See, we will.
Thank you, sir.
We will move as soon as we will be away from the pandemic. We would like to have all three people at our college also, personally.
It's good to be associated with your college. And I really stand for contributing these things to the people and particularly the student. And it's really, and this is really an opportunity for me to do the things which I love to do most. Right? And contributing to the students.
Yeah.
Thank you, Professor, for inviting us.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.
Yes, sir. Thank you.